I can't think of a worse way to start a video than a cat coming in and dropping a huge deuce behind you. But that's exactly how I'm starting my video. But thankfully, it's cheap video, one take. You guys can't get the 3D, much less the 4D or the smell. But that's what I'm up against today. Hey, how y'all doing? It's Crestail Crow back again to give you an update on my Dark Tide conversion figure that I've been developing, and some of you guys have been getting a kick following along with it. Listening to Thunderkiss 65. Oh my god, man. Listen, some of you guys relate with me. Some of you probably are maybe a bit too young to relate with me, and some of you probably just find me impossible to relate with. But was White Zombie not the shit in the 90s, man? Like, holy crap, their music was amazing, man. So, yeah, when I was here last, last time I made a video, I kind of was just finishing priming the figurine that I was calling Bull, and I think you guys were seeing that at that stage. Just to talk a little bit about where I got some of those pieces. I talked about heating up that plastic card and things like that, but yeah, I think I covered enough where I got those pieces, but I just wanted to remind you, like, the helmet I'm working on, if you pay attention to the bump helmet attempt I'm making, that little piece right here at the side, this one, is actually the backside. It's from this. It's that backpack off this droid, which if I go do conversions, I'm gonna have to keep some of these Star Wars Legion battle droids that I was left with after I sold off my my collection, a game I never played but painted hundreds of miniatures for. Yeah, I keep this here as a reminder, just to give me a kick. Like I said, when I worked on the hovercrafts, and I'll get back to those, that they're on the list. But when I'm doing the Joe conversions, I'm having a kick at where I'm getting some of these parts. Like, I can see the limbs and everything being good for like little actuators on the sides of weapons or whatever, you know. Like, I was just having a kick with that, so I just thought it would be fun to show you. So what else did I wanted to recap? I just wanted to say we've gotten up about to 164 or 5, somewhere at 63 maybe, but I just wanted to say thank you very much for passing around my videos, if you've been doing around that, or passing my name around there to say worth checking out. And talking about my 200 and 350 contest, and knowing that, you know, there's prizes and whatnot, and letting people know, you know, about the channel. Thanks very much. And for the new subscribers, thanks for tuning in. I hope you get a kick out of the crap I do. And I've been interacting with a lot of you, and I've been having a great time. And I really am enjoying this channel. This is a good hobby. I'm having a great time with this hobby. And this whole conversion process has just been really reminding me of the best parts I found with tabletop gaming was always painting and creating, like adding on to whatever these kits had and re-envisioning certain things. I was always into conversions. I got into Hot Wheels conversions. I showed you that at one point, but they just didn't feel the same. It wasn't as comfortable. Making Joe ones makes sense, but I'm kind of trying not to get too overzealous about it. I am having some struggles with this figurine, which is a Todd McFarlane Dark Tide figurine, right? And if you guys haven't been following, it's this one. And I'm a little ashamed of how I bought it. I bought it at full price at EB Games. And I think every other figure they had on that shelf was at like a reduced price, except for the Artist Proof blank one. And that was at the regular price, and they didn't give me the discount. And I think if I had just waited a little longer, I'd passed on opportunities to buy this before, and I remember it being at a lower price. So maybe that's what you get when you pass by a good deal. That was my lesson. But I could definitely see myself wanting to buy more of these. Yeah, at least the Imperial Guard and perhaps the Chaos Trader version of it. And maybe some of the, I can see a conversion potential with the ones that are unsculpted, when you combine it with putties like this green stuff that I've been using on the tack vest on my guy, and I'm going to show you this guy in a second and just talk you through. But I'll remind you guys, if you're enjoying these things, hit like, share, subscribe. Let's grow that algorithm. Get it up to 200 so I can do that giveaway. What was the giveaway again? It was the, I am giving away this guy wherever I put him. There he is. At 200, I'm going to be giving this guy away to somebody out there. We'll have a fun little contest. I'll announce when that goes once we hit 200 and I'm back home and doing stuff. So I'm going to try and follow formats. I talked about this last one, guys. Without my meds, I've been a freaking mess, man. It's been embarrassing how messy I've been. And it's just come around for the last little while. I've bounced around so often now that I've clearly lost a lot of my own admin just without the meds and without thinking. I wasn't paying attention to stuff. So if you guys are having a conversation with me and I ever lose track of something and it affects you, I deeply apologize. That's happened to a couple of you in a different way. Thankfully, all of you are really good about it when and you can relate. So what am I talking about today? So this head-to-toe thing is what I'm going to follow, but I'm going to get, there's no file card for my guy, and remember my guy, I'm calling him Bull, and it starts with the sketches, but remember that Bull, the challenge was to take everything that was Imperial Guard 40k about the guy and try and shift it over to a more Hasbro classified line, but I wanted to do it in a way that I was building a Canadian contribution to the Joes. So, you know, if you've watched the first two videos, there's a lot of brainstorming and creative development in that. I had a picture of what I wanted the guy to look like. And it's starting to come together now. I'm happy about that. And then I have to understand its place in there. So I was thinking, okay, well, I am really enjoying converting and I could see me doing a lot of these. So I'm thinking I'm going to probably pick up a couple of other figures when I see them on sale, either for some of them will be for the contest for sure, and then when I go to England, I'm gonna try and get some Valorverse figures too, and maybe I'll be able to find a good deal there, but I don't think so. But I'll definitely probably surprise myself with how many I buy. Yeah, everything more than one would surprise me, but I'm definitely gonna pick up at least two or three. I know that. But the point being is I can see myself getting into this conversion thing. And yeah, if Loki wore tooth, if you're watching Loki, like I said, I promote him a fair amount. He's a model Misfits 1138 on Instagram, and I'm gonna pull up a picture of what's being combined with the Bull sketch that's driving me to finish this, right? So yeah, I think here it is. This is the big piece that was driving me. I've been talking to my buddy there, Aaron, my other buddy, Aaron. Yeah, so I have two friends now named Aaron, very supportive of my channel, and that's great. And I always go back to, hey, Ron, are you here? Aaron, right? Waiting for somebody to raise their hand. Motherfucker, are you Aaron or not? So yeah, it's this. Adding this to what I'm trying to conceptualize as a Canadian Albertan farm boy kind of Joe thing is what I'm working with. He's going to be a heavy assault trooper. So body armor, heavy weapon, mask. I hope the mask works out, all the additional armor, and trying to get him away from this Imperial Guard 40k feel and into something more natural, which is very hard to do when they come with these oversized rifles that just fit in nowhere else. I thought I had it sitting over there, but got my glasses on and I have to take them on and off to look for things when they're too far away. But anyways, the rifle just, it was in the first video. It's just oversized and I could look at adapting it later, but the priority is for this. And so when I was conceptualizing, I said I was going to do some graffiti art on certain pads. I'm going to combine an attempt at doing graffiti art with layering some things like decals onto the thing and then putting a decal thing on there. You see I'm wearing this glove. It's because when I pick it up, if it's not fully dry, and this is going to speak to why I have to put some varnish over it afterwards, and I have to hand brush it lightly because my airbrush is down. My compressor is great. My airbrush pin broke, and I'm in no hurry to replace it before Christmas. But what's ending up going on here is this is what we're looking at now, and I'll just try and tame down some of the light. And actually, one second, I'll pull this up. Yeah, yeah, yeah. You wait, please, and I'll come over. Oh, one of you is watching at a time. Yeah, there we go. This is a live event. We don't have to worry about it. There we go. And yeah, so my glove, there we are. So I said I was going to go for a brown kind of effect with it. Brown and tan. I've been able to do that. I get getting the green layered into the, some of the armor plating, and then you see where the white is on the other shin there. That's where I plan on having some of that graffiti, but I'm using just the flat blacks, and I'm gonna anything that I have armor plating right now is really gonna be about being flat black and gunmetal and doing some dry brushing. But this is getting ready for just a few more touch-ups, and it's going to be a wash and then a heavy amount of detailing, and probably maybe a second wash and then a dry brush, and then I'll seal it in. It's coming along. I did the belt buckle conversion for the bison, like the cattle skull, to cover up the Imperial Guard design, and then the chest plate. I realized I had kind of offset those mag pouch, like those, they aren't mag pouches, they're just pouches. One seems to be a little bit on an angle, and that's fine because I plan on stacking a couple of smoke grenades under them, or a piece of graffiti that he wants showing on that, on this plate here, where my middle finger is not telling you to do anything, just look here. Yeah, and then we'll add some stuff to the straps. I want to seal in where the colors are. You got to see it. And then there's that pin I put in that frag grenade. That's our crack grenade, as I think they call it in 40K, if I remember right. I put a spoon in a pin system, and it's a crappy pin, but maybe I'll be able to hide it later. And I covered up some of their existing tech, so it wasn't quite so... noticeables there. I plan on having one standard issued kind of knee pad and one very graffiti disc one. Like I don't know, I'm gonna have to really see how these decals work with the sealer and how I'm working with them, because this one I could see being on the black knee pad here, right? Sorry, is that showing? There we go. I wanted to do that one on there, but I'll just keep that up, and then if I'm understanding what the backpack systems that are being 3D printed by Loki, and I'm definitely gonna have to look at ordering some more, you know, like trying to get some more out of them, guys. Like, go have a look at his catalog, make friends with Loki Wartooth and Model Misfits, try this stuff out, because like I said, I'm gonna be throwing some of the stuff into the 350 prize to let you guys try, you know, do your thing. But have as much, if you're artistically inclined and you want to try it, you'll get some supplies to do just that. Maybe I'm learning one way, maybe you guys will find a better way. I seem to like to learn everything the hard way, right? So there's the back. I'm gonna have to Dremel a hole. I'm probably gonna high mount it over this plate so I can use this plate to support whatever backpack I'm putting on it, because I think that 50 cal or Gatling backpack system that he's using, or any other backpack system he's using, he's got a lot of modern supports on there. They look very, very familiar to a veteran in the frameworks and things like that. And I can add a little bit of green stuff if I wanted more fabric, but he's got it down. And I think just that plate, either I keep it or it'll be there as support, or I'll have to maybe sand it down. I don't know. We'll see. I'm not going to sand it down. We'll make it work. And then the vest, I'm going to have to do some other stuff. So the arms are coming along. I haven't touched the gloves so much, but I'm just going to quickly show you. These are the inner ring sockets, and these are the only things that come out of there. Joe, I find, has their butterfly joints are more intricate and have more parts that function inside and don't slide out so much. This I preferred, actually, and that's unfortunately only with my McFarlane Riptide, whatever, or Darktide line with these figures. So I don't know. He does have very limited articulation. As you can see, I haven't finished doing a lot of the primary painting. You can see where some of it has peeled off because I wasn't wearing gloves at one point, or the gloves were getting dirty and it was pulling off. And you can see why. As soon as I'm done, I'm sealing it. Like tonight before I go to bed, I'm hopefully getting around to, I'm going to bend the legs and seal one side of the knee paint. Because if I take it around to the back, you can see how those hinges, I've painted them, but I've done so knowing they're going to wear. So I think tonight I'm going to paint the back of the knees with a varnish finish to protect the paint as best I can. See how that works. If it doesn't work, well, I might just say fuck it and just see what works and what doesn't and take this all as a learning experience as it was intended, right? Some of our greatest successes come from our worst failures. Well, maybe not our worst failures, but anyways, over here, I wanted to just, there's the bump helmet I'm working on. Here, I want to put it over. I want to move the camera where I can see what you're looking at. It's just hard like this. I've got to get a better video system. I'm clearly going to focus on that. And that's the one thing. Why is he so bumbling and persistent at doing this? Well, it's because I want you guys to see the difference after January when, or for, sorry, February begins. January is when the appointment is. After I start getting my medication back, I want you guys to see the difference in the channel. And as I do other things, will I make it anything other than a one take? Maybe. I don't know. We'll see. When I can focus, we'll do. But I'm having such a blast with that. So that's my bump helmet. There's that droid backpack. And it's just sitting with a basic, coat of desert tan. And then I did a flesh wash on it just to mark where I want later to be grit and where I want fabric and stuff like that and padding. And you can see how their neck joint system works. It's that morning star system kind of thing. And then there's just some extra padding for holding like a tech piece in there. Sorry, a little pouch, I guess it is. And then just a couple of switches I have, that's all. And then I will be adding a lens to the front of the add-on camera part that I did. I'm leaving this NVG mount alone until I have the right idea for what I'm doing about that mask. If you guys remember, I've got that flip down mask I want to add, and it's going to work in conjunction with the neck thing that I'm trying to do for it, like that, right? Let's get that. Oh, there it goes. There's your crusty crow. So you can see I'm kind of working a couple of concepts. Whether or not they work out isn't the point. It's what failed and where are my limitations and constraints as a hobbyist right now, and where do I want to watch more videos, and which videos do I not want to watch that I'm kind of just enjoying it my way, right? So that's what this is. So armor plating's going to go on tonight. I think this black stuff over here, that's going to go on tonight. This I'm hoping to incorporate into the front of the neck piece. All this is, guys, is you know those cheap dollar store vice grips that you can buy in the hardware aisle, like little, medium, large? This is the tip of one of those just primed up because I like the mesh. It looks like either a speaker or just reinforced grated metal. And then I did a quick thing with the face and then did a wash, and then I'll do some dry brush highlighting to it and just play with it. But I'm not very good with face layers. Like, one, I'm colorblind. I'll always fall back on that. That's why I wasn't a combat photographer or anything like that, or a pilot. I wanted to be a helicopter pilot, but they don't take colorblind folks. Neither does the combat photographers. Anyways, you can see kind of the scar I put on there using just a little bit of green stuff instead of cutting into the face, which I was very tempted to do. But yeah, all learning experiences for me, and that'll fit back nicely in the helmet. Let's talk about the shoulder flash I'm trying, because I finally got my concept proper last night. And I was thinking about, you know, what Canada brings to the table for our special forces, right? We have our Cantsoff Palm, and you know, like our Canadian special operations groups, and then we have our joint task force, and most of us don't know much more beyond just kind of the outline of their job, the kind of stuff they appear to do and stuff like that. But we don't interact. We don't, like Army, we work with them, but we don't get deep in them. They're usually attached to us at best. I had one op that I can remember for sure that involved them. And I never actually even met them. We were supporting them, right? So don't know, but I know guys that went and tried out for them, the Joint Task Force here, and a couple of them made it and a couple didn't. And you learn some stuff, but I'm not talking about all that. I'm just trying to find, where would a Canadian fit in with an American, like, company, I guess. A company, what would you call them? A brigade or division? Branch. Let's call them a branch. A branch. Like G.I. Joe. I always thought G.I. Joe should just stand for Global Intelligence. I thought it was a pretty good one. I know it's General Infantry, but Global Intelligence in this sense makes more sense, right? I think so. And Joe clearly is an anonymous factor for its contributing agents. That would make sense for what G.I. Joe would stand for. So where would a Canadian, they would have to be detached from their unit and attached to Joe, right? They'd have to be an at. And you look at Big Ben. Big Ben's a prime example. And I'm just, keep it moving around. But Big Ben was, in my mind, kind of like the British SAS's detachment that went and worked with Joe, right? And we should get more of that. I think that's good. Like Germany, that would be a great one to get. Germany, Italy, France, whoever. You guys know how I feel about October Guard. So I think every conversion I do from this point forward is going to be about the joint, my Joe Joint Task Force detachment from the north. And I have a good reason for why this is working out. Because, guys, if you're not up on the old movies, but some of us older ones are, you'll recall it happened in history, the Devil's Brigade. Right? And, the Devil's Brigade, they had one movie, but it was Canadians and American. It was a contingent of Canadian and American troops working together. I think Brits were in there as well. But it was a mixed group, right? And they went off and did terrible things to the Nazis, right? In their campaigns, like just total mischievous missions. And they were, I thought it was a really cool concept I knew about when I was a kid and then verified that this was history. And I went and looked into it and I pulled up their motto. And that's what I was going to get at with this sketchbook and show you was, bear with me, guys. You're just following along for shits and giggles. You can fast forward at any point, right? There's some of the concept sketches, right? So, and I'm working with that as a backup, right? And you can see I wanted to get ambitious and do a crow thing. I don't think I'll get that ambitious, but I will try to get that Griffey bull on there and maybe something, a nod to one of those. I have a set of eyes I want to do on his bump helmet that I think works with a bull. But where was that? Did I write it down? They have mottos, and I had the German motto for it and everything like that, but it's basically the Devil's Brigade's motto was translated from German, and pardon me if I don't have it, but it was like Wirst ich Goblin, whatever. I had it written down. I'll share it some other time in writing, but it meant the worst is yet to come. That was the Devil's Brigade motto back in World War II, right? So I decided I was going to build something attributing that. I didn't want to call it Devil's Brigade, so I'm just calling them the Red Devils. That's why I'm using this. So red for Canada, because if you call them White Devils, I'm going to have a whole different problem on my hand. Especially, no one wants to make October Guard. You're not going to play with White Devils. So I was going to go with just Devils. So any kind of decals, it could be note, because they're just, they don't exist, right? So it's just fun. So that'll end up as one of the shoulder flashes at some point. You see how I'm kind of just giving myself some options on how I'm going to occupy those. Gloves will probably get some painted. I am probably going to occupy this space somehow with something just to draw away from its origins. I do have a bit of green stuff left, but I'd like to use other little small bits that would look like tech. So yeah, these guys' motto is the worst is here, right? So yeah, it would make sense. So the worst is yet to come for their predecessors, and the worst is here, I think, is a good slap on the face. I thought it was good, like, without insulting anything and just paying homage to some military history and having fun as a Canadian. And fun, you know, and screw you if you don't want to play. You know, I just thought that was fun, and I might do a German one, or you know, some other nationality. Kind of opens it up for just converting a lot of stuff and just kind of mind dumping some creativity from a sketchbook, like from your mind to your sketchbook to your table. I'm having a blast. So what do I think of the Riptide figure as far as the value, guys? I paid $30 for this. About $30, I paid $25 after my discount with my card, because it was a GameStop purchase. But I've seen them go down even lower. Like, I've seen them go probably under $20 here in Canada. I know some of you already have them, so you're already familiar with them. But the artist proof I found, it's, I know, guys, like, I have this feeling there's guys that are in-case collectors for stuff like that, and they're the same guys that would buy one of the blank variants for a Marvel comic where there's nothing drawn on it, just the artist proof cover. Those exist, and people buy them. And they would probably put them away. No. Blank canvas. It's being shared. You got to do something with it if you are the kind of person that does those sorts of things. Highly recommend, if you're going to ever want to try and do a Joker version for the first time, this is a great thing for me to learn on. It's a great thing for anybody wanting to try, just to learn on at a very... no hit. Like, what happens if you fail? You know, like, it was never a classified figure anyways. But if you succeed, you've got a pretty decent custom classified figure. So definitely hitting up the 3D prints off Loki's site and at Model Misfits 1138 on Insta. I'm gonna be probably ordering another thing after the new year there, and definitely, yeah, throwing some more interest his way. He's got a lot of good stuff I want to, and he's been talking to me. He's like, I can print this, I can print that. I'm like, I told him what I'm picturing, right? I want to do at least a few. And he's like, yeah, I can support that. Just give me a minute, right? So I talked about all that. I told you about the design considerations for all of that. I showed you all the hinges before, where the limitations and constraints are. I did think, like, you got to understand, like, that figure, sorry, it's better for me to just show you in the box, but I am trying to show you, like, I am making progress. This is going to clearly take me a couple more days, and I won't do update videos all the time. Just felt like that was significant enough. But that figure, where did I put that box? There it is. If you have a look at it, I immediately was so happy with the way it was, and I committed to this idea of that heavy assault trooper kind of thing, like I talked about with the Barricade figure from the 80s line. But I completely overlooked, it's just as good as a Cobra Crimson Guard kind of immortal figure, I think. And, you know, I really had to flip a coin on trying to decide what I was going to do with it. So I think if I buy another one, I might try my hand at doing that even more differently, or playing around with it more. I'm not saying I will, but I'm saying if I found it on sale again, I think rather than trying to mirror anything I do with Bull, I would try to do the Crimson Guard Immortal, because he's big. He's like 6'8" by, you know, if you were to do a size comparison, but he's about a 7-inch figure almost, right? There and abouts. So that's where we're going to leave it for today, guys. Remember, if you like these videos, like, share, subscribe, bump that algorithm along for us so we can get to that 200, and I can mail that Cobra troop builder off. And like I said, I'm going to pick up some more. Some will be for prize pools for that 350. I've got time, clearly, and that's fine. And I just wanted to thank everybody again for your time and your interest in the stuff I'm doing and kind of the way I'm going. I laugh, man. I have not been able to really set roots anywhere for a few years. And no matter where I go, as soon as I pull out the hobby desk, wherever I am is home, right? Like, it doesn't matter if I don't feel at home anywhere else with boxes and if this house I just moved into. As soon as I set up a hobby station and get back to work, things are good. So I just wanted to thank Loki Wartooth. I want to thank both the Aarons out there. How's that? And there, that would make things easier if I could just remember to do it twice, eh? Anyways, thanks guys, and thank you for the rest of you. You guys are really awesome. Have a great one. Bye.